when you have a good knowledge of pharmaceutics, you can actually make your career in formulation development department of the research and development, R&D. You can work in the production, it's your choice. Or you can also try in the regulatory affairs or IPR departments of industry. So what is this regulatory affair? It is talking about making a dossier before you get a permission to launch your product in any foreign countries. In a regulated market, they have their own guidelines. So you need to make a dossier and file your application there. Only when their regulatory body approves it, you get a license to sell that product in their market. So every multinational company, or for that matter, all Indian companies also have a strong regulatory department. And they require pharmacy people having good knowledge of regulations, regulatory affairs to represent this department. Yeah. And IPR, that is intellectual property right. So every company will have a patent set, because any idea which is novel, any product which is developed as a novel product has to be first patented. And if your product gets the patent, you can enjoy the patent life for 20 years, the monopoly for that product for 20 years. So every company would have an effective IPR cell. And I'm showing certain good company, Indian companies, Dr. Reddy's, Cipla, Glenmark, Ranbaxy, yeah, Abbott is of course US company. So there you can definitely try your career in the departments, any one of these departments, or many more companies. These are a few examples of good companies. Then medicinal and analytical chemistry. So these are not joined together as one subject, but for the convenience, I'm placing both subjects together. So it is this medicinal chemistry. What is medicinal chemistry? So we spoke about pharmacy as a profession, which talks about discovery of the drug. So it is this design and discovery which is required to be done with good, strong medicinal chemistry knowledge. Okay. And there you have some fascinating computational approaches like computer-aided drug designing, where you have a software, and on software you have a programming. So you have something called HIT, that is the receptor, something which is mimicking receptors in your body. You know, receptors like some protein, G protein we call it as, or some kind of enzyme which is a hit, which is available in the body. That is the place at which drug is supposed to get hit. Okay, so these hits are available in the software program, and you are going to optimize, synthesize, develop a lead, that is a molecule which can hit that target. So that is that hit optimization, lead optimization is done using computation software. And then we get lot of new drugs which are called, coming under the category of computer aided drug designing, developed using this particular technique. The in silico technique, advanced technique, it requires computer software. And once you have designed some molecule, you're going to take it into the lab and see actually you're going to synthesize this, but that is going to save you a lot of time in trial and error. This is going to be a very, very systematic approach towards drug discovery. And it is also going to be cost effective. So this is one of the key projects that are being done at a research level in medicinal chemistry. Analytical chemistry is important because unless you standardize the drug, how can you give it in the hands of the consumable? Now that is the key feature of any allopathic product. All these products are standardized. They are tested by quality control department. And there is a strict control by the state food and drug administration about the quality of the drug. Yeah. So how do you test the quality? You require some analytical techniques. And then I was talking about the clinical trials where we are finding out the drug level in the blood. Now these levels are very minute. It can be microgram, it can be nanogram. So you require very advanced techniques of detection of these drug blood levels, or standardizing the medicine in the laboratory, which is available in the market. That is all standardized medicine, right? So for this, we have a pharmaceutical analytical chemistry or analysis as one of the subjects. And when you have a good knowledge in this area, you can make your career in drug designing or computational chemistry or bulk drug synthesis, where you are synthesizing the drug in large bulk quantity of kilos and tons. Polymer chemistry, yes, because every new implantable formulation is a made of polymer. All novel drug delivery systems require new formulation, nanotechnology formulations require polymers. Okay, so that itself is a big branch. And you can work in the quality control, quality assurance. Yeah, so these are various areas which are available. Pharmacology, you're going to study extensively at various level, level 1, level 2, level 3. Now, this particular subject is studied by even medical practitioners. MBBS program has pharmacology, but I have spoken to so many doctors and always they accept that pharmacology is the subject which they found as very tough. So that itself shows that pharmacy, we people do pharmacology at various levels with great interest and lot of involvement. Yeah, but this subject is about the drug, and this drug, which is the mechanism by which it is producing effect in the drug. We do not just have the application knowledge, but we know the reasoning behind it. Why a particular drug is effective? Where does it act in the body? What are the various places, we call it as receptor, where it performs its action? And if you want to reverse its action, or you want to block some, you have in the body some neurotransmitters and you really don't want them to produce their effect, maybe because some person is hypertensive and you want to reduce his blood pressure. Some person has a asthma and you don't want the broncho constriction happening. So you know that there are some neurotransmitters which are causing this effect, and you have some other agents which are blocking the effect of these neurotransmitters. These are your drugs. These are your medicines. So it is that pharmacology which talks about every drug and its mechanism of action. What body does to it and what drug does to the body, that is studied in pharmacology. So drug produces effect by acting on certain target site, and body ultimately has to eliminate the drug, stop that effect at some point of time. You know, the action should be terminated somewhere. So that is called metabolism and elimination of the drug. So all these things we study in detail in pharmacology. Then we also study anatomy, physiology, and pathophysiology at again three levels, where entire body, its anatomy, human body, and we study every system very minutely. A new nervous system, central nervous, autonomous, reproductory, then circulatory, excretory, all those systems anatomically, how does it function? Everything is studied, okay, in the branch of pharmacology. Under that you have anatomy, physiology, and pathophysiology. So very interesting. All those who have a feeling, array, I missed my medicine admission, I'm going to enjoy this subject so well, so thoroughly, you want to enjoy it. And then here we do a lot of studies on animals. We call it as preclinical studies. We carry out clinical trials. There's a knowledge that you get for conducting these trials. Then we have, so when it comes to career scope, you will work as a part of the industry which is dealing with all these types of developmental work for the new molecule, animal studies, that is preclinical, then testing of animal in the human being, clinical data management. I spoke about clinical trials. So there is a huge clinical research that is happening. That is, a new molecule is being tested on the human being. So it is happening at multiple centers, multiple hospitals, and huge data that is getting generated, you know? And this data is required to be archived. It is required to be statistically analyzed. And it should be made available to the company who's going to license that particular product in a particular market. And before licensing it, that company requires approval by Drug Controller General of India, if it is India, or some other regulator where it is a foreign country, right? So this clinical data, which is required to be managed and it is to be used by the industry who is going to be the licensing, for that you require the clinical data management or clinical data manager, clinical research associate, all these posts, clinical researcher, these posts are required in the industry. And there are companies like Quintiles, Ciro, then Lambda, and there are many more CROs, which clinical research organizations, which carry out this type of drug, this type of work, and clinical data management is a very, very important field where you have a job opportunities. Medical underwriting, this is a kind of profession where insurance company would be asking for medical underwriter. So insurance companies, you are not going to get the coverage, whatever you ask for, you know. The company has to first assess you as a person. What is your lifestyle? What is your medical history? What is your family history? And whether a particular risk it can be taken of giving a particular coverage, whether that person is more or less healthy, and there are very less chances that he's going to claim for the particular, for the insurance, you know, that is required to be assessed. The coverage amount is required to be decided based on the risk that we are taking. So this risk assessor is supposed to be of medical or paramedical background. So pharma people have got a lot of opportunity as a medical underwriter in the insurance companies. Aditya Birla Group every year comes to our campus, so we know what is that type of job, and our students are doing very well as a medical underwriter. Medico marketing, so when any product comes to your hand, the label has a lot of things written. I don't know whether you have read on the label carefully, or if you have any container, there is some insert inside, you know, a paper which is nicely folded and placed. Now you are going to become a pharmacist, so you need to read that paper carefully, and you will come to know it has a lot of information, and it is this information which is made by medico marketing department. What is that drug? What is its dose? What is its mechanism of action? How does it get absorbed, distributed, and metabolized, eliminated? What are the indications? What are the contraindications? What are the side effects? Everything is written in that small paper which comes with your product. So it is the department of medical in the pharma industry which deals with all this literature and a lot more literature that medical representatives present to the doctor when they go for detailing of the product. Okay, so it is the work of medico marketing. Going ahead, so when you have good knowledge of pharmacology, you have opportunities to be a part of any one of these departments. And you will, pharmacovigilance is one more department where it is all about safety, safety and safety. Your product has to be safe. And pharmacovigilance has got a huge data compilation about the adverse drug effect of a particular drug. So that particular drug or a medicine, not just in our country, but in the entire globe, if it is used, what kind of adverse drug effects are noted? What are the kind of effects noted in the pregnant woman, the breastfeeding woman? What are the effects that are noted in some immunocompromised patient? Okay, so all this data about the safety is available, and there are companies who are working in pharmacovigilance who are constantly updating on this data. And this safety data is required to be produced by the industry, by a particular company to the regulator from time to time to ensure that product is safe and it is really not providing any harm to the consumer. So it is that pharmacovigilance department which keeps on generating that safety data. Pharmacognosy, very interesting field. Everything is green here in the slide. It means that your product is coming from the green origin, from the plant origin. But it's not that you're directly going to eat leaves or roots or stem, but you need to extract and purify the drug that is available in the herb. So it is this pharmacognosy field which is going to first help you, which is going to train you to authenticate the medicine, whether it is the right medicinal plant, how do you authenticate it, and then further, how do you extract the phytoconstituents, the important constituents from it, how do you cultivate it on large scale if you want to just make it as a production for a medicinal garden, and what are the conditions required for cultivating, all these things you study as a science in the field called pharmacognosy. And you are really, you develop interest in herbals through that, and you can become a good herbal formulation development scientist. And also you can become you can be a part of herbal cosmetic industry. You all have heard about Vicco, Himalaya, Dabur, Patanjali. There are so many, Unilever, the biggest player in the market for consumable goods. So all these companies have got a very wide range of herbal cosmetic industry and products. And they require a person like us who know the knowledge, who have a knowledge of formulation development, and who have a knowledge of good pharmacognosy, cognostic skills, and that is how we can be a part of this particular industry. Clinical pharmacy is about directly dealing with the patient, with the community, understanding patient's need, explaining him about the formulation, and optimizing the use of medication by working closely with the doctors and medico healthcare teams, okay, and ensuring the wellness of the patient and disease prevention. That's the work that you do in clinical pharmacy. So again, here some preclinical trial, clinical trial, pharmacovigilance, hospital administration, community pharmacy, all these fields are going to come. And you can see there are so many hospital chains, Fortis hai, Apollo hai, Sayadri, Vocard, you know, there they require a clinical pharmacologist. And this clinical pharmacologist becomes a part of a very efficient healthcare management team who monitors the effect of drug on the patient and who actually closely watches whether any adverse effects are happening or any kind of problems are happening or any kind of drug-drug interaction that is taking place. And for that, you require good knowledge of clinical pharmacy. Biotechnology and microbiology, another area. Now, many people had opted for earlier, might have tried about BSc biotechnology, BSc microbiology. So you all know about it. That is the use of living organism for certain purpose. It can be in the pharma industry, it can be in the food industry, it can be in the textile industry. You know, that microorganism is being used by using a fermentation technology. And this is being used for manufacturing some biological molecule, okay, or some protein and polypeptide, which is used as a drug, okay. So you all have heard about insulin. So earlier, when diabetic patient, especially those whose pancreas do not synthesize, secrete insulin, they always require injection insulin. That is, they are called as type 1 diabetic mellitus patient. So these patients require insulin. Earlier, old age, when I maybe in 80s, we were dependent only on bovine, that is a cattle source. So I was talking about insulin. So why did I mention about insulin? Because each one of you know about diabetes, and everyone knows that is one of the major disorders globally, you know, and it is supposed to be the seventh big killer, you know, that kind of, if that is not well managed. So what is that diabetes? It requires some treatment, and insulin is one of the prime medicine that is required to manage the patients having uncontrolled drug blood level. So earlier it used to be given through, it used to be extracted from cattle, that is bovine source, or from pigs' pancreas. But this insulin used to give a lot of allergic responses in the patient. Some allergic immunological responses were seen, because that is the insulin amino acid sequence in that insulin was not similar to that found in the human insulin. So now there is something called humulin, where the amino acid sequence is exactly matching with that for the human insulin is being made. And that human insulin is not extracted from pancreas of human, but it is made in the laboratory using DNA recombinant technology. So I mentioned one drug, insulin. Likewise, there can be many drugs. Monoclonal antibodies are there, which are used for treating arthritis, for treating cancer. They are based on biotechnology. There is something called gene therapy, which is based on the principles of biotechnology. Gene therapy is, there is a defective gene and we are just repairing the gene, okay, by giving a genome, a DNA, having a correct gene sequence there. So we are restoring the condition of the health of that patient, okay, by preventing the damaging because of the or avoiding the damaging effect of that defective gene, that is gene therapy. So gene therapy, stem cell therapy, DNA recombinant technology, all these terms you have heard, but biotechnology gives you the basics and knowledge about this particular field. And in our science, we do teach you about these two important aspects of drug discovery and development. So I mentioned about a few, and you really have good career in future, and you can develop, you can pursue your post-graduation in these, you know, life sciences or biotechnology in India or abroad after completing your pharmacy graduation. And you can see these molecules. If I read a couple of brands, each brand has a cost, value, sales turnover of more than $1 billion. So you can imagine how big these brands are. You can see the sales, the amount, the costing given, 9.2 sales, you know, US dollar, billion, 9.2 billion US dollar sales for one molecule, Avastin, okay? and the company is Roche. It is not molecule, it's a brand name. And this is used for oncology, the chemotherapy. And then there are many such, you know, I have listed a few biosimilars. Okay. So all these are made using biotechnology, and you can see they have such a big share in the total turnover. Okay. And they're very big brands, big, huge sales industry gets through these particular brands. So basically, I have given you in nutshell about some overview of pharma profession, pharmaceutical syllabus, and you will realize that it is a good blend of basic sciences, physics, chemistry, and biology, and applied sciences, that is pharmaceutical technology and clinical sciences. That is our pharmacy profession. So you need to, you have already cleared your 12th and cleared your CET or NEET, and you're going to have 4 years degree program. After that, if you wish to pursue post-graduation, there is a post-graduation entrance exam called GPAT, conducted at All India level. Then you get admitted for master's, and then you have a PhD or doctorate program. And sometimes you can directly enter into bachelor for program at by lateral entry directly into second year BPharm if you have completed your diploma program after 12th standard. There is PharmD program, which is called as doctorate in pharmacy. And this particular program of doctorate in pharmacy is of 10 plus 2 plus 6 years duration. And PharmD people would have more scope in the hospital setups as a clinical pharmacologist. And there are certain universities, to name a few, Manipal University, Bharati Vidyapeeth, Dean University, Pune, JSS University, they offer this program. There is also one program called as BPharm post-baccalaureate, and that is 3 years after BPharm, PharmD post-baccalaureate, PharmD post-baccalaureate, and that is after 3 years after BPharm. This is the duration, okay? So after pharmacy, I've already given you a lot of departments where you will have scope. You can also select the commercial line where you can do your MBA, MMS, PGDM. You can do a regulatory affair course in diploma. You can and work in the regulatory affair department. You can carry out your career, continue and pursue your career in clinical research by acquiring some short-term courses in clinical research. You can go abroad and do your master's. And we have a lot of students going abroad. Almost 30% students go abroad every year. So a lot of scope. There is no end to it. And I have already covered some important sectors there. And when I'm talking about commercial role, I'm talking about sales, marketing, business development, brand management, for which MBA is essential. You can also have your career in supply chain. Okay, these are all commercial roles. And this is very important. You can also go into government jobs. So you have a lot of regulators. When it is a pharma product, there'll be a lot of regulation. So you have Central Regulatory Agency, you have Drug Controller General of India, you have Central Drug Standard Control Organization called as CDSCO, or you have a FDA zonal offices. Everywhere there is a post advertised for the pharmacist and senior post, drug inspector post. So you can definitely opt for such government jobs. Coming to the colleges that we have. So every year, one pharmacy college or two colleges are adding in under University of Mumbai. So we have almost 29 total colleges and 2,360 intake. We have 3 aided colleges, 26 unaided colleges. We have Sindhi linguistic minority, 3 colleges. So just give me a minute. So you can see Sindhi, you want to go? You can. You have Sindhi linguistic, Tamil linguistic, Hindi linguistic, Christian linguistic and Muslim, not linguistic, minority, sorry. Sindhi, Tamil, Hindi linguistic minority, Christian, Muslim, religious minority. So why do I show these colleges to you here? Because you need to know these colleges will have 50% quota reserved for a particular community, particular category of students. Now, in CAP round 1, we are filling all these seats. or government is filling the seats under these categories. Okay, so government is allotting seats to the students of this category over that 50% reservation. So in gap round one, you might have seen in many colleges which have a minority status, the vacancy seat that was seen was huge in number. For example, in our college, you might have seen 64 vacant seats. What does it mean? Are they going to remain vacant forever? No, obviously not. It means that in round one, very few people from this minority community have reported. So the seats are lying vacant. They have not given open it to general category. But the government is going to open it for the general category in round two. So in CAP round two, you will see that all these seats are now available for every candidate. First preference is given to minority, but if minority candidate is not available, it will be then open to a general category. Okay, so in Sindhi linguistic minority, I know our college, then L.H. Hiranandani College at Ullasnagar, K.M. Kundanani College at Kulaba. In Tamil linguistic minority, we have Saraswati Vidyavan's College at Dombivli. Hindi linguistic, there are two colleges, Oriental College at Sanpada and HK College at Jogeshwari. Christian minority, there is one college, St. John's College, Palghar. Muslim minority, there is one college, Anjuman Islam College at Panvel. Then we have, these are some colleges. Now, ICT is a deemed university, you know it. Then the Siusha College is SNDT, that is Women's University. But they are also aided colleges. Bombay College of Pharmacy, K.M. Kundanani, they are aided colleges. Quite established. 1957 is the establishment year for BCP. K.M. Kundanani is after that, 1971. Then in 94, many colleges came. And then slowly, in phases, some colleges were established. And you can see the list of colleges here. Saraswati Vidya Bhavan, which is at Dombivli, Tamil linguistic minority. Bharati Vidyapeth, which is at Belapur. When there is no minority status, they do not have 50% seats reserved in that minority. But no seat remains vacant. Government sees whether that particular candidate is available. If not, so government converts it to the general category. Because ultimately, education should be made available to all. Okay. Then these are some more colleges, and most of them are unaided colleges. So I showed 29. So this is how, you know, when I graduated, there were only two colleges, BCP and KMK. I graduated in 88, and now there are 29 colleges. And in pharmacy, as I mentioned, there's a lot of demand. So all these colleges are coming up and their seats are getting nicely filled. Okay. And now something about this CAP process. You all have taken part into CAP process. So you have been allotted the institute. So there is a step of self-verification. Now, after that, we are going to see the software will see whether what is your first preference. Okay. Now, if it is a first preference, then there is a auto freeze. That means it gets automatically freezed, right? And then when it gets automatically freezed, you have to accept it by paying the seat acceptance fee, which is of 1,000 rupees, and you pay it online. And once you pay the seat acceptance fee, you have option, that is you have only option, that is you have to report to institute and take the admission. If you have a first preference which has been allotted to you and you have paid the fees and accepted the seat, but you have not reported to the institute, then you are out of CAP. That is, you cannot take part in round two. Okay. Now, if you have been given a first preference and you have not paid the seat acceptance fee, then also you are out of CAP. You cannot take part in round two. Now, if you have got the allotment of a seat for an option which is other than your first preference, right? If it is a first preference allotment, it is an auto freeze. But if you have a allotment which is other than first preference, then what are the choices that you have? You wanted that college. See, you have accepted that particular seat and you have freezed it. It is not auto freeze because that is not first option. So it is a self-freeze option. So voluntarily you have freezed it and you have paid the fees for that particular seat. Seat acceptance fee is paid. Then what are the options? you have to report to institute and take the admission. If you don't report to institute, again, you are out of CAP. So you cannot take part in round two. And directly, you can try your luck at institute level quota. Okay, the vacancy against CAP or management's institute level seats. For that, you can try. But you cannot take part in the CAP. Now, it was the allotment, which is other than your first preference. But you did not pay the seat acceptance fee. Then in that case, you can take part in CAP round 2, but the allotment that you got, you have lost claim on that allotment. So in round 2, when you will start filling the option form, the seat that was allotted to you in round 1 will not be shown. You will have to fill the form afresh. Whatever allotment you had got in the previous round, that claim you have lost because you did not pay the seat acceptance fee. And third is that you have paid the seat acceptance fee and you have gone for not freeze option. That means for the betterment. You have not freezed it, but you have accepted the seat. It means what? You have paid the fee, but you have not freezed it. This is the wisest decision that you have made and you are eligible for round 2. Okay, and you have also retained the claim of whatever seat that you got in the previous round. So if you get the better seat than that you got in the previous round, earlier round, then your CAP 1 allotment is cancelled and you will get the betterment. And if you are not getting the better seat, then whatever was allotted to you earlier is retained with you. Okay, so that is what is the beauty of this entire process, which is so much friendly to students and parents and which is taking care of options that you can look for while participating. Okay, now we are into the schedule of this CAP rounds and we are on date 21st. Now here the provisional vacancy seats are available. You can see, you can log in through MHCET website and you can see Maharashtra CET website will show you the vacancy position and there you will be able to see how many seats are vacant in every college. Now you will see in minority colleges, because I see today morning, so I can tell you that in our college 65 seats are shown vacant. So why so? Because all over 51 seats, only one candidate who was from Sindhi minority reported. All seats got opened now for round 2. So likewise, there will be suddenly a kind of lottery. All minority institutions would show a surge of seats. It means that their minority seats have remained vacant and government has opened it for the non-minority candidates. Okay, so you see the vacancy position for every institution. You have shortlisted some institutions. Be happy to see the vacancy position there. Do not be skeptical about minority institution. You can get admitted even in the minority seats, minority colleges. It is not necessary that you have that minority status. Okay, and just take part in this process very wisely. Okay, by making a calculated proper decision. Now round 2 option forms you have to fill today and tomorrow, and then there'll be allotment, and on 25th you'll be able to see the allotment, and from 27 to 29 you have to report to the institute and then you have to secure the seat, and then all those who have this is about CAP allotment, and all those who did not get the proper seat through CAP, for them also there will be institute level rounds. So you can definitely apply to various colleges. Maybe I can say the date can be then in that case 29th, because 29th is the last day of reporting from CAP round 2. So maybe on 30th all these colleges would give you an option of applying for vacancy against CAP. Some colleges might have started accepting the forms, but they cannot make the merit list before 29th. Then they'll be making a merit list and it will be displayed, and they will give you, and they will make a schedule for the admission at institute level seat. So you will come to know about their institute level seats available after the cap round by checking on their website or on their notice board. They have to put it on the website also. So you will come to know how many seats are available for vacancy against CAP, and definitely till 5th February, you can go and secure admission there. Now, some of you might have taken admission somewhere to be on the safer side, and then you really afterwards realize that there is some betterment option available. Then government has kept a provision for cancellation. You can cancel the seat in the previous institute and take admission to the institute where there is a vacancy. So student has to cancel through his login. Once he does the cancellation through his login, in the list of students of institution, that seat appears as cancelled. So you have to officially take a print of acknowledgement of cancellation and present it to the institute where you are going to take admission, where you had taken admission. And then you have to apply for the refund of fees and return of all original documents, and then go to the new institute and secure your admission. So within 4 days, every institute has to return the original documents and has to refund the entire fee that you have paid if you are canceling the admission, provided you are doing it before the cutoff date. If you are canceling the admission after the cutoff date, there'll be only the caution money that would be refunded to you. Rest all fee will be forfeited. You will not get the refund of fee if there is a cancellation after the cutoff date. However, if you are canceling it before the cutoff date, which is seen as 5th February, then you are entitled for the refund of entire fees minus 1,000 rupees as a processing fee. 1,000 rupees only will be deducted, rest all will be refunded to you. And this is not something that a favor that institute is doing to you. That's the rule of government, which every institute has to abide by. So institute level admissions, these admissions also require online registration and document verification. Those who have got already a merit list, they don't have to worry. Those who are right now registering, they will just miss that window of registration. They can still register, but they will not get the merit number. They will be always treated for non-CAP seats. They will not be entertained for the CAP seats. And so that registration process will be continued till 5th February, registration and document verification. So cancellation rules I have already explained to you, and these are available on the DT brochure. You can read it on the MHCET brochure. You can read it very carefully, okay? And you should not be confused or anxious about all these rules. Then this is another important step that is called as online pre-admission registration. But this particular registration is not with CET, state CET, but it is with University of Mumbai or any affiliating university. Okay, so you have to go to this university site. This is a university site, digital http://mum.digitaluniversity.ac. And there you have to register, you get user ID and password. You only give your user ID password. With that, you can the university website will direct you to the place where you have to fill up all your information and do the pre-admission registration. So this is a mandatory step for enrollment with the Mumbai University. It has to be done. So some students might have taken admission in Mumbai University, but in other programs like BSc. So before you join pharma program now, make sure that you cancel admission at the BSc college. You just write a letter to the principal stating that please cancel my admission and withdraw my documents which have gone to the university for enrollment. Please do that, because if you are enrolled in that particular college forgot to withdraw your application, then what will happen when your pharma college will start enrolling you? It will be shown that you are already enrolled and you are a student of some other BSc program. So please apply for your previous college cancellation and please request the principal to withdraw your papers from university enrollment process. So while selecting the institutions, make a very informed decision, see the track record of professionalism and ethical policies of the institution's management, how many years of establishment that management has, whether it has earned a name for its professional dealings, you need to know. So I want to give some gist of our college also here. We have 57 years of establishment and we are a part of Vivekananda Education Society, a very, very reputed educational trust. And our colleges in engineering, management, law, architecture, arts, science, commerce are very well established institutions. Okay. And pharmacy college has started in 2007. So we as management is known for its professional dealings. You need to know the student teacher ratio. In the sense, there will be adequate, there should be adequate number of teachers. The ratio for BPharm is supposed to be 15:1. That is, for every one student, there should be 15 teachers available. And for MPharm, that ratio is 10:1. You need to, it is just not enough that you have met the number, but you need to have quality staff. That means the teaching staff should be qualified, experienced. If they have industrial background, all the more better, yeah. And there should be good research happening in that institution. So government expects that there's a good blend of teachers with good experience, medium experience, freshers, you know, there's a good blend. And people with a lot of industrial experience are also there in their team. That is expected by government. So I'm proud to say that we have that blend. We have people having 20 plus experience like me. We have professors with us working. We have a 9 to 15 years bracket also, a lot of people and the youngsters also, a very good blend. And I have many teachers having 10 plus years of industrial experience. So this is really, I feel proud to say, share this with all of you. You need to give personal, you need to consider whether institution is able to give a personalized attention to the students. Through initiatives like mentoring cell, personal counseling, career guidance cell, parent-teacher meetings as a regular practice. Because when this happens, your institution, your management, it's constantly in touch with your children, your students. They are in touch with parents. And students are being continuously guided. Okay, so that you need to see whether there is that environment with. If there are hostel facilities, all the more nice. Then what efforts institution is taking to enhance the employability? Whether there are efforts for holistic development of students, whether there's a campus to, we have, for example, campus to corporate transition cell. So right from same one to same eight, we conduct a lot of programs to help students to become employable, to make them strong in soft skills, develop their confidence, help them to present themselves professionally, improve their community skills, communication skills. And we also introduce a lot of eminent industry scientists from industry and academia to interact with students. That is how we try to develop their extra peripheral knowledge in pharmacy beyond syllabus. So you need to check whether every institution has such type of drive before you take admission anywhere. Yeah. And of course, good infrastructure, good facilities, how many labs do they have, whether there are all equipment there, because it is a professional program. So you need to have well-equipped labs. If there is an animal house which is approved by government, so that it is the government of India, CPCSCA, so that at post-graduation research, you can do some animal work, animal studies. How is the library? Whether there is online reading material available, everything you have to check. And all these things you can check through the website of institutions. Okay, for us, you can always log in and check through this website, vs.ac.in/pharmacy. You have to also see, talk to the alumni of that institution. You come to know a lot when you interact with the passed out student from any organization. So you get a lot of confidence when alumni says, yes, this is a very nice college. When parents of alumni say, yeah, this college takes best care of children. Then you really, as a parent also, you feel confident to admit your child in that institution. Discipline and rule is very important, because unless there is a discipline, you cannot get the output, you know. So if you are self-disciplined, well and good, or somebody should be there to discipline you so that you can manage the time so well, and many things you can do while pursuing your graduation, and you can actually keep on making your CV stronger and stronger. So check whether institution has a discipline for everything, you know, and there is a ragging free environment. There is absolutely no unfair things that are happening. This is very important. See whether your institution is registered, it's approved by Pharmacy Council of India under Section 12. Only then the child can be a registered pharmacist if the institution is approved under Section 12. Okay, so I was talking about discipline. So attendance is another thing where there has to be a discipline. You might have seen some colleges, junior colleges, which are very particular about the attendance. But there you may be grumbling because you were attending a lot of other coaching classes. But in professional programs, there is no coaching. So if institution has a very robust mechanism to monitor the attendance, it so happened that initially students do not understand the importance of it and they tend to miss the classes. But with institution's policy for a good attendance monitoring, we avoid that kind of filtration. We make sure that all students are attending, and automatically they develop interest and the results get improved. So we believe in 100% of percent conduction of classes, and so we believe in 100% attendance, and we do monitor it, and we take a feedback from students to make sure whether they are enjoying classes and we are able to deliver what is expected to be delivered. Accreditation, yes, please check whether your institution is accredited by NBA, National Board of Accreditation, which is for the professional institutions. There is a NAC accreditation. If it is there are both accreditation, well and good, or at least NBA accreditation has to be there, National Board of Accreditation, which is based on Washington Accord. So there are a few good things that we have a corporate membership of National Center for Quality Management. So we have got an award for best education quality enhancement through this particular organization. We have got a vision of inculcating entrepreneurship aptitude. And with this vision, we have a pre-incubation center, and there is a seven-storied building that is coming up for incubation center. And we encourage our students to have their own startup. And if they could do it over that 4 years of period, nothing like that. And our institute will give them an ecosystem to have their own startup, to have to help them to nurture their innovative idea and convert it into a sustainable business. So I was talking about that institution's innovation cell, which we have, and through this cell, we inculcate the values of entrepreneurship through our students. We have a Rotaract Club. So many students want to give back to society. And when we are pharma professionals, we have to give back to society. So in Rotaract Club, you get a lot of opportunity to do some social work, healthcare related work. This is our institution. Institute code number is 3237. This is given to us by DTE. So you can search for the institutions through code also. So I mentioned this code number 3237. This entire seven-storied building, you can see this is just the pharmacy college. There is no other program conducted in this building, totally dedicated for B-Pharm program, M-Pharm, and PhD. At national level, we have some footprints, like in as per National Institutional Ranking Framework. Consistently, earlier we were placed in the rank band of 51 to 75, and we achieved this position at all India level when we had not even completed 10 years of our establishment. And currently our rank is 63rd, but we are trying hard to be among top 50. And ARIA, that is Atal Ranking of Institutions for Innovative Achievement, there we are placed in band B. That is, all India level, we are placed in the rank of 26 to 50. That's a band, okay? And I have already talked about MBA accreditation. We are accredited by MBA. And these are some students. And this is something which is, again, very prestigious. We received an award, first award at all India level. This was conferred to us by AICTE and CII jointly where through for the survey that they conducted for industry linkages of the institutions. So we were considered as the best industry linked institute, and we were given first award in 2018. And you can see some snapshots where our students, our research scholars in PhD, they have received a gold medal at the inter-university research convention. Am I audible, Pratik sir?
Yes.
Okay. If there is a problem, please let me know. So what is important here is, this is very important, whether you have infrastructure, whether you have a self-employment initiatives. Self-employment means startup, entrepreneurship. Whether institution is encouraging such type of initiatives by having institutions, innovation council, incubation center. Yes, WESCOP does that. Whether you have a collaborative research projects going on with the industry. Yes, we have a lot of collaborators of, and we are having a lot of research in with pharma industry. Whether you have a post-graduation research center, and whether that MPharm program is being supported by seminars, visits, industrial training, add-on courses. Yes, we do it at WESCOP. And whether in your governance, there is a presence of industry, whether they are on your board for advice, maybe in the research, or they are helping you in IPR, intellectual property right, please do check. This is important. This is how you have to work closely with the industry. These are some of our employers. And these are some of the projects that we have completed or we are doing with the industry. He's our founder, who was really a visionary, a very simple person, and who gave his entire life for the community, for the society. He was into politics, but he never brought politics in the institution. Because of his legacy, now our all professional courses do not have a capitation fee or management quota. We surrender all 100% seats to government for admission through centralized admission program. And only when there is a vacancy against centralized admission process, we fill it at institute level. So I'm really, I bow to Ashuji Advani, who had set this kind of policy for VES. These are all our organizations under VES. We have Arts Science Commerce College, which has come way back in 84. Then in 94, Management College started. In 79, Arts Science Commerce started. In 84, Engineering College started. 94, Management College. And last year, Architecture College started. 2009, Law College has come under VES. So these are our team members. So you can see we have a professional research advisor, Professor Nagarsekar Madam, who has a very extensive experience. And earlier, she was a HOD and professor of Bombay College of Pharmacy, and she's our research advisor here. We have many other professors, Dr. Ganga, Dr. Rajeshri, a professor, Dr. Mushtaq, HOD, Dr. Anita, she's an associate professor. And you can see all of them have a very good blend of teaching and industrial experience. Recently, we have received some trophies, and if you please do visit our website, and I am proud to say that our college has been listed or featured in Higher Education Digest magazine as one of the top colleges, 25 must watch pharmacy colleges in India. So our college is featured in Higher Education Digest, and this college digest link we have given on our website if you wish to read more about institution. So we also have 2F12B certification, and most importantly, we have a CSIRO status. Some of you parents may be having pharma background. So CSIRO is Scientific and Industrial Research Organization. That status you get under Department of Science and Industrial Research, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. And if you have a CSIRO status, when you are importing some equipment, you are exempted from excise duty. So some awards, accolades that I have received as a principal. And these are some gold medals that our students, our research scholars have got. And so this year we got the championship in medicine and pharmacy category. This was given to us by University of Mumbai for gold medals that we earned in the Inter-University Research Convention. These are the programs that WESCOP offers: BPharm, MPharm program in pharmaceutics, quality assurance, PharmChem, PhD program in pharmaceutics, and PhD program in PharmChem. That's it. And I would like to conclude by saying that you need to have a lot of interest in this field that you are selecting, and you should be mentally prepared to spend quite a number of years in that field that you have chosen. And you might have realized that pharmacy is a booming career, and please pharmacy is your career. Thank you very much for your patience.